beautiful thing, you know, when we have a moment to bless somebody, to encourage somebody. I had posted something on Facebook that the Lord had given me about just providing rest for the weary. And and it was just, I forget exactly how I worded it, but it was a post saying, Lord, please give somebody rest that is reading this post right now, because they need that rest. They need to get rid of the stress in their life. And Carol's niece wrote me a note and said that she wasn't even on Facebook at the time, but somehow her phone pull up that post. How about that? Don't you love when you hear about a miracle? I mean, she wasn't even on Facebook. I don't know how she got to the post. You hear what I'm saying? She was doing something else. And this post that I had posted popped up. And she was having such difficult time with her daughter. I mean, waking up in the middle of the night screaming and running around the house like oppressive spirits were trying to oppress the family. And it was really not a pleasant situation. And of course, during the day as well, this child was like uncontrollable, and it was just a really difficult situation. And my wife's niece, her name is Karen, was just so upset about it. It was like, how do I get this under control? You know, and there was just no way. It seemed like it was a difficult thing. Any of us that raised children, we all understand those moments, right? And the difficulties that you can have. And then the Lord caused her to see that post, and it was like a Holy Spirit rain that just fell on her. It was like, and I wasn't praying for her specifically. God gave me a post, which he does many times, that will, you know, maybe you just throw it out to 5,000 people and maybe a couple hundred may see it, you know, maybe 40 or 50 may see it, whatever. You can put things out there and it's exposed to thousands of people, but only maybe a few would see it. But I said, Lord, help the ones who need to see it, see it.
That's right.
And in this case, Karen wasn't even on Facebook, and this post came up from me. The text that she wrote me was just, she was overwhelmed with what God had done for her and then breaking the powers of the enemy over the child. She said, it's like a different child. Kingsley's like a different child. Sleeping good, no problems with behavior during the day. I mean, it changed her situation dramatically. Amen. Amen. And that's why it's so important. That's what that song is talking about. Don't miss the moment that you have. Always get up every day and say, Lord, drop an opportunity in my path so that I'll be able to bless somebody today in some way. Amen. And God will do that. Even in supernatural ways, which is really what happened here. Something supernatural that happened because she saw that post and she shouldn't have, but she did. Amen. And it changed her situation in her house. Amen. God wants to use you today. He wants to do something through you today. Two people look out the same window. One see the stars, one see the mud. Amen. That's exactly right. You know, oh, isn't that awful outside? Look at this, and the weather is this. Or somebody would say, hey, you know, God has really blessed us, and today is a wonderful day. Like Al May used to say, what a wonderful day for Jesus to come back. And that's a beautiful thing. Amen. When's the last time you released something that was in your heart that God told you to release? Amen. It's so important to do that, because I know God has people waiting for us. Amen. To listen to what we're going to say, because the Lord has blessed us. Amen?
Amen.
Somebody said amen.
Amen.
Lord, bless us now as we look into your word this morning. May the word of God be a blessing to us, O God. I pray that you will touch us, O God, in a special way. In Jesus' name. Oh, come on. Somebody pray for me and hold out your hands out toward me right now. Come on, guys. Amen.
Yes.
We're going to talk to you about this Christmas season, about the heart of Jesus. Amen. For the last couple of months, it's been just consuming me in my heart and my spirit about the heart of Jesus. And you know how the Lord will give you a theme or something in your heart, in your spirit, that is just that God is literally saying something to you or through you. Amen. And in many cases, he's saying something to you so he can work through you. Amen. And the heart of Jesus is going to be our theme now over the next few weeks. And then, of course, there's so many ways of looking at the heart of Jesus. And today, the Lord has just spoke into my spirit. And this is such an important thing to understand this. God wants us to see the simplicity that is in Christ. Amen. And the heart of Jesus is in Matthew 11:29. I've given you some of these notes in your bulletin. Not all. I couldn't fit them all. But it says, I am meek and lowly in heart. And that's in Matthew 11:29. Okay, there is no pomp or display in either of the qualities mentioned there. And they both belong to the gentle order of virtue, so to speak. And we are generally not regarded highly among the average person in the world. Amen. If you say somebody is meek and lowly in heart, it usually doesn't excite somebody. Amen. Today in the political world and in the world that we live in, everything's got to be spectacular. Everything's got to be big, big and better and, you know, more good looking, more money, everything. The first is the word meek, and it is used in the New Testament in the third beatitude. Okay, as we read the book of Matthew and the fifth chapter, it says, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Amen. Now that is a sermon unto itself, which I will not go into this morning, but that's a powerful part. And it's really how the Sermon on the Mount started out. Jesus had this incredible beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, and we call them the Beatitudes today. And of course, it's blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. And by Peter, when speaking of the ornament of a meek and a quiet spirit, amen. Oh, this is in the Bible, Pastor? Yeah, it is in the Bible, amen, that we are to have a meek and a quiet spirit. And of our Lord also said, behold, thy king comes to thee, meek and sitting upon a donkey and upon a donkey's colt, amen. A donkey's colt is what? Is the baby of a donkey, amen. A donkey is insignificant animal, not like, I mean, with all that pomp and that moment that he had, with the palms and everybody shouting hallelujah and hosanna. I mean, he could have been on a big white horse, amen, at that point. I mean, I'm the king and I'm coming in to announce my coming into the city of Jerusalem. And Jesus, the Son of God, chose to do it a different way, didn't he? Amen. Behold, thy king cometh to thee, meek and sitting upon a donkey and on a donkey's colt. The word has the signification of mild, gentle, soft, and meek. Such is the heart of Jesus. Amen. And you will observe that Jesus Christ says concerning himself, I am meek in heart. We're going to talk about meekness in just a moment. It is remarkable that Moses also recorded in the 12th chapter of the book of Numbers the fact that he was remarkable for meekness. Now the man knows Moses was very meek above all the men that were upon the face of the earth. It actually says in another version that he was the meekest man on the earth. Moses, the great immortal man, Moses that parted the Red Sea, we're talking about. Same guy. Amen. And the Bible says he was the meekest man in all the earth. I believe that Moses, guided by infallible inspiration, wrote that description of himself for our example and was utterly free from all vain glory in doing so. Do you believe that? I do. Amen. Just as our blessed Lord in all lowliness here spoke concerning himself and said, I am meek and lowly in heart. You know, true meekness never seeks its own attention. And when it does assert itself, it always has an eye to benefit someone else. Amen. Always with an eye to benefit someone else. So the other adjective which we're looking at here is lowly, because it says, I'm meek and lowly in heart. It is used in Romans where Paul says, mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Well, we're talking about today simplifying your life. Simplifying your life is a big thing. Amen. We have a great Christmas movie that we watch, and it's a great story of a guy that comes in and is taken off the airport floor and given a blessing of staying overnight at a stranger's house. But then he goes in and starts to, you know, make some observations of how these people are celebrating Christmas. And he said, here, let me help you simplify. And he starts to do that. And of course, he became a little offensive and he had to apologize because everybody celebrates Christmas in their own way. Amen. But it's a beautiful thing to think with a simple mind. Amen. That's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about simplifying your life. He resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. As we read in the first epistle of Peter, he is not lofty, proud, or haughty, and he dwelt with the humble and contrite, and he associated with men of low estate. We're talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, amen, such as the religious men of the day scorned upon and looked down on. Yeah, they scorned upon it and they looked down on him. Wow. This is getting like powerful, guys, thinking about this. Let's read on. He made himself of no reputation. We're talking about the Lord Jesus now, the Son of God. Amen. He made himself of no reputation. He took upon him the form of a servant. And when he was reviled, he reviled not again. He did not strive, nor cry, nor cause his voice to be heard in the streets. Amen. Wow. Now, this description of the heart of Christ may be a head turner or a mind blower, so to speak. Meek men are often misunderstood, are they not? Amen. Boy, isn't that the truth? Amen. But listen to this. Listen carefully. Don't miss this. Christ said, I am meek and I can pardon your ingratitude and your disrespect and forgive your profanity and your blasphemy, your insult, your scorn, your enmity, your malice, because I am meek. A meek spirit gives you the ability to forgive. It gives you the ability to forgive. Listen to what the pastor is saying. It's one of the secrets of life, guys, is forgiving and letting people go that hurt you. Somebody hurt you this week. I can almost guarantee it. Jesus said offenses will come. Somebody did. Somebody said something to offend you. I can almost guarantee that. Meekness is not weakness. Now listen carefully what God gave me this many years ago. Say meekness is not weakness. But it is a full submission to the Holy Spirit. So meekness is not weakness. Many times it's viewed as being weak. If somebody is meek, they're viewed as weak. And they're not weak at all, but a full submission to the Holy Spirit. Christ only did what he saw the Father do and spoke only what he heard the Father speak. Amen. He was in total submission to the Father. Amen. And if you want to enjoy your life and simplify your life a little bit, try doing this. Only do what you see the Father do. And only say what you hear the Father say. Get into a submission to Father God at that level. And your life will be simplified. Amen. Amen. Come on, somebody said amen. Amen. Because I'm telling you right now, you're under pressure from the world. You're under pressure from the news media. You're under pressure from the political parties. Oh yeah, we don't need a donkey or an elephant. We just need the Lamb. Amen. Hallelujah. Meekness and lowliness of heart are also opposed to a haughty spirit. And Jesus did not seek the empty glories of pomp and state. Neither did he desire honor from men. He did not speak proudly to those around him and never domineered over other people. Amen. Or exercised lordship over them, as Jewish leaders and many proud Gentiles of the day did. Amen. He was surrounded with not too nice people, guys. Amen. Come on. Jesus came into a world that hated him day one. Hated him day one. And he's still hated today, 2,000 years later. Isn't that amazing? It's amazing. The poor and the sick could easily move his heart to pity and his hand to help. Why? He was called the friend of the publicans and sinners. And of him it was said that this man receives sinners and eats with them. And he was criticized for that. He sought out the hurting. He sought out the lost and the sick, the confused and the misled. Amen. That's what Jesus did. You want to simplify your life? Live in this realm. Amen. He sought out the hurting, the lost, the sick, the confused, the misled. That's what a meek and lowly heart causes us to do. Never holding ourselves above others in a proud spirit. Amen. As a teacher, Jesus was meek and lowly in heart, and therefore was the very opposite of the scribes. Amen. Just the opposite of what he was around, the Jewish leaders of the day. If you saw a Pharisee in Christ's day, you would have seen the incarnation of pride. The incarnation of pride. He professed by his very name to be a select being in dress, manner, conversation. He sat himself up to be some great one, and he would not come in contact with a sinner if he could help it. That's exactly the way the Pharisees thought. Oh, I'm not even going to come in there because I'll be polluted by these evil sinners in this room. Remember when the Pharisees came when Jesus was having dinner with Matthew, right after Matthew had been called by God, amen, to be one of the disciples? And they had a banquet for all his friends. He was a tax collector, guys, amen. He probably had some not too nice friends. You hear what I'm saying? Maybe some from the Red Quarter, amen. Do you hear what I'm saying? And then of course the Pharisees caught them doing that. What in the world are you doing? And they said, come on in and join us for dinner. Oh, we wouldn't do that. We would be polluted by this evil that's in this house. I'm trying to point out to you why it was that Jesus had simplicity. If you saw a Pharisee in Christ's day, you would have seen the incarnation of pride, human pride. The Pharisee professed by his very nature to be a select person in dress and his manner, conversation. He set himself up over everyone else. Amen. But Christ was gentle and willing to associate with the vilest of the vile, the lowest of the low, for he was lowly in heart. What we're doing, we're examining here the heart of Christ. We're talking about what is the heart of Christ this Christmas, the heart of Jesus. What better subject could I pick? And it was just something the Holy Spirit said, yes, that's the subject for this Christmas. We got to look at the heart of Christ. Amen. And there's no way we can cover it in 1 month between now and New Year's, but we can touch on certain things that will really make a difference in our life. Amen. It is true that our Savior was meek and lowly in appearance, for even in his greatest moment, he rode a donkey, the colt of a donkey, and not upon a horse, which indicated state and pomp. He had the opening. He had the opportunity at that moment and did not do it. He was ever lowly in manner. And when he uttered the glad message of the gospel, he was very gentle. Yet the meekness and lowliness of Christ were not things of just manner and what he said, not just in word alone, but he was that way in his heart. Amen. We're looking at the heart of Jesus in our series this Christmas, the heart of Jesus. Today, we're focusing on simplicity. God's been really speaking to me about this, guys. I'm telling you. And I believe me, I just really believe God wants to speak to us all. He wants our life to be simplified. Amen. And there's a lot of things we can do to simplify our life. He was not of those who act in false humility. That's another thing you ran into all the time back then. And you still do today. You know what false humility is? People use that to secure power. They use false humility, especially among other Christians, to secure respect and honor from other people. Amen. Even though they're not genuine in true humility. Someone one time wrote, there are some that use the look of humility to serve their pride. And that's true. That happens. And sometimes appear humble, but are using a naturally gentle nature to express their opinion and control other people. And that happens all the time. Amen. It's called false humility. Beware of that. Amen. Beware of that. This is interesting. It is said of Thomas A. Becket that he acted in the greatest lowliness and humility. For this reason, he washed the feet of 13 beggars every morning. Yet he was an arrogant person and had no respect for the king, no respect for authority. He wasn't a good person, but he was trying to make it look like he was a good person. And lorded over his king, and he was the proudest of the proud, though he pretended to be the humblest of the humble. You hear what I'm saying? False humility. The Bible has a lot to say about that. Amen. Many men have concealed inordinate pride beneath a crouching manner, mimicking humility while harboring arrogance. Amen. And this is so important. I'm just going to touch on that because I believe that we just need to be aware of that. Amen. His heart was with the common people. Now we're back to talking about Jesus now. Jesus' heart was with the common people. He did not force himself down a natural haughtiness to be constrained, okay, to a constrained contact with the lowly. But he became a real friend of sinners. Amen. He was drawn to the sinners. He was drawn to the lowly. He was drawn to the common people. And yes, the children loved him too. That tells me a lot about who Jesus was. Amen. That tells me a lot. He rejoiced in spirit when he said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent and hast revealed them unto babes. Amen. He was excited when the lowly people, the humble people, the common people, not those with titles, but the commoners, if you will, came to him and wanted to know about what he was teaching. They wanted to understand. And he was excited about that. Amen. He rejoiced in spirit when he said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast hid things from the wise and prudent and hast revealed them unto babes. Amen. That was a beautiful thing that he said. His heart was meek and lowly. It was the very nature to be clear of anger and pride and passion and enmity. Jesus lived what was in his heart, and His whole nature and everything about him was the essence of the Father. Amen. It will further help us understand that Christ's meekness is a virtue to forgive us of past offenses. Amen. Come unto me, he said, you sinners, and however much you may have offended in the past, I am meek and easily to be entreated. I am ready to forgive, to forget, and cast behind my back all of your provocations. Amen. Isn't that beautiful? Amen. I don't know whether this is hitting you guys or not. This hit me so strong. It hit me like the side of a truck hit me. It was just like the Holy Spirit was speaking to me. Like, this is what we need to go after. That's why we sung that song, The Heart of Christmas. Don't miss it. Don't miss the moment. Don't miss the moment to hug a stranger. Don't miss the moment to give a stranger a smile. Amen. The next time you're in the shop, right, look at people. I look at people all the time, and it's amazing how many people are really nice out there. Amen. They're not all bad. There's a lot of good people in South Jersey. Amen. I run into them all the time in the Wawa. I run into them all the time in the shop, right? I mean, people that smile and talk, and then if you say something spiritual, even in the least little sense, most of them agree. Absolutely. You can connect, believe me, they're out there. But if you're going to look at everything negative, this place that we live in, New Jersey, Negadelphia, as it's been called, and things of that nature. Yeah, if you look for them, you'll find them. But if you don't look for them, you look for the good people, you'll find them too. Amen? Good. Somebody said amen. Amen. We're talking about simplifying our life today, guys. Amen. Now, how do we apply this heart of Jesus? Isn't this beautiful? This heart of Jesus that we've been talking about for the last, 20 minutes? I just gave you just a little glimpse of what the heart of Christ was all about. It started out with that scripture in Matthew 11:29, where it said, I am meek and lowly in heart. What does simplicity mean spiritually? Simplicity aims at loosening inordinate attachment to owning and having. Amen. Simplicity brings freedom, and with that freedom brings generosity. You know, there's nothing wrong with having money. It's when money has you, right, is where the problem lies. Amen. The scripture doesn't teach that money is evil. It says the love and worship of money is evil. Amen. So you could be a millionaire and be in the center of God's will. You could be a billionaire. Nothing wrong, nothing sinful with having money. It's when you worship it and when it has control of you, that's where the problem lies. Amen. You talk about bringing freedom, and with that freedom comes generosity. Amen. We sing a great song in this church called Give It Away. And it's talking about two kinds of people in this world. Givers and takers. I think there's three kinds. I think there's givers, takers, and receivers. Because somebody has to learn how to receive in order to give the other person the opportunity to give. Yes. Amen? Amen? So you need to humbly receive sometimes too. So I say, oh, I just want to give. I just want. Well, that's beautiful. It's more blessed to give than to receive. And we know that. However, when somebody wants to bless you, that's an opportunity to give them the opportunity to be a giver. Amen. So I think that's important. The Bible refers to the simplicity that is in Christ. That's in 2 Corinthians 11:3. Sometimes we may feel that we have to be smarter to formulate a complicated prayer or a complicated approach to take on a painful situation. No, you pray, Carol has been diagnosed with cancer. So you simply just pray the same prayer as you would for somebody that has a common cold. You hear what I'm saying? Amen. The blood of Jesus has been shed for us all. Amen. The blood of Jesus has been shed, and Christ has died on the cross to pay the price for all of our sin, not just some, but all. Amen. And it's by His grace we are healed. Amen. We're not healed because we're a better person than somebody else. That'll never happen. Amen. All healing is by the grace of God. Amen. It's by what God has done. Amen. And what Christ has done. So sometimes we may feel that we have to be smarter to formulate some complicated special prayer. No, just come to God and love on Jesus like we sang this morning. And He loves you so much. Remember, the price has already been paid. We're already healed when He said it is finished. We are already healed. By the stripes of Jesus, we have been healed. That's past tense. Amen. And Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that we will understand it better than ever, oh God, that we will understand the grace of God when it comes to healing. Amen. A simple, honest receptivity to divine truth is all that you need. Amen. Divine truth is really all that you need. Matthew 6, 22 to 24, Jesus urges a single-mindedness. The teaching here involves simplicity of intention in living one's life. In light of the verse, Matthew 6:33, verse 24 shows we must focus our attention on our highest priorities at all times. Amen. Getting our priorities out of order is a common problem that we have. Amen. We get our priorities out of order. Keeping our priorities in order in life, in our families, in our homes, in the church. Why is a revival needed in the church? Because people have got their priorities out of order. Why is there problems in homes? Priorities are gotten out of order. Amen. Simplicity simply means focusing on what really matters. Amen. Focusing on what really matters. Amen. He even said that it was easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Jesus made that incredible statement. Now, the eye of a needle is a place, by the way. It's in Israel, and it's a very low place that's very difficult to walk through. So it is actually a place. Don't think of it as a needle, as you know what a needle is, okay? It was actually a place in Israel. But what Jesus was saying is that it was easier for a camel, which would be almost impossible for a camel to go through there, because even a short person had a hard time getting through this place, okay? It would be easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. Now, he was not saying that it's wrong to be rich. That's not what he was saying. It's called priorities, amen. He lived what he taught, owning no property, remaining unmarried, okay? Working as an itinerant rabbi and teacher, okay? A healer, dependent on the hospitality of his friends. Come on, we all know a little bit about Jesus, don't we? He never went to college. He never was a professional, quote unquote, professional rabbi. He never owned a home. He never owned any kind of transportation that we know of. You think he would have had his own horse, for example? There's no indication in Scripture that he did. Maybe he did, it's just not mentioned. He never owned any form of transportation. He was not impressive or physically attractive. It tells us that in Isaiah, the 53rd chapter, that when we see him, he will not be attractive, not someone that you will desire after. Okay? In other words, he wasn't photogenic, maybe. Or maybe he wasn't the kind of a person that everybody was so attracted to because he was so good looking. So handsome, so beautiful. He never drew attention to himself. He attached himself to the humble town of Nazareth. He introduced himself by saying, "Hello, I'm Jesus of Nazareth." And that's all throughout Scripture. He said that over and over. Nazareth was a lowly town. It was poor. It only had a few hundred people living there. His parents, no doubt, were poor, and there wasn't much money involved with their living and the way they lived. But he attached himself to the humble town. In fact, one time it was said, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Because everybody looked down on that town. Everybody looked down on that city. It wasn't like other cities that were wealthy and rich that maybe were closer to the sea and they had the fishing trade to feed the money or whatever it may be. No, Nazareth was not that way at all. He attached himself to the humble town of Nazareth and he actually introduced himself as, "Hello, I'm Jesus of Nazareth." He didn't say, I'm Jesus of Galilee or I'm Jesus of Bethsaida or maybe, one of those more wealthy towns. He connected with the lowly. He was loved by children and common people. He only did what he saw the Father doing, and he was never politically correct. He was never politically correct. He saw no need of that at all. Amen. He never did anything that would associate with greatness. He lived in the absence of luxury, pretentiousness, and ornament. This was the Son of God we're talking about here, guys. Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the prophesied one that King David prophesied of 1,000 years before it even happened. He lived in the life of plainness, a life of simplicity, freedom from the guilt of guile. He lived a life of simplicity. Amen. He showed the example of that. Now, I'm not saying, and the Bible doesn't say, that you've got to dress plain or not have a nice car. It doesn't say you can't have a nice house to live in. The Lord blesses us with good things. It's a posture of the mind I'm talking about. Poverty is a posture of the mind. Wealth is a posture of the mind is what it is. Amen. It's how you think, how you approach other people, how you approach life, how you approach the issues of life. Amen. That's what he was talking about. What is the simplicity of God in the Bible? The simplicity of God means God is not made up of his attributes. He does not consist of goodness, mercy, justice, and power. No, God doesn't consist of those things. No, he is goodness. He is mercy. He is justice and power. Every attribute to God is identical with his essence. Amen. Hallelujah. So Jesus didn't heal. He was the healer. Amen. You hear what I'm saying? He never told us even to pray for the sick. Although there's nothing wrong with praying for the sick. There's scripture to support that. What I'm just simply saying was he told his apostles, go and heal the sick. Go and heal the sick. That's the spiritual authority that has been given to the believer. A message I put out on YouTube a couple weeks ago. I hope you listened to it. On the spiritual authority of the believer. We need to understand that. Christian simplicity is not just a faddish attempt to respond to the chaotic and the materialistic world in which we find ourselves. It is a call given to every Christian in every age to follow Jesus Christ. Amen. Everybody is called to follow Jesus. Amen. And did you know that everybody, there's not one person on this planet that doesn't want Jesus. They just don't understand that they want him. Who wouldn't want life? Who wouldn't want healing? Who wouldn't want eternal life? Who wouldn't want the joy? Who wouldn't want what Jesus offers? Everybody wants that. I don't care whether you're a Muslim, a Hindu, a Buddhist, or an atheist. It doesn't matter who you are. You all want that. We just don't associate it with him. We associate it with a church, with a sign out front, with a denomination, with a bad experience that you had in the past of your life, or whatever it may be. That's what you associated with. And Jesus should not be associated with that. Amen. Hallelujah. We are here just to point to him. Amen. The day that you hear Steve Burton, the day that you worship a church sign or a denomination or a church name or a doctrine or any of those things, you are off base spiritually at that point. My job as the pastor of this church is to point you to Christ, to point you to Jesus Christ. Amen. And the day that I stop pointing you to Jesus Christ is the day that you should leave this church. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
I'm here to point you to Christ. Amen. I'm here to point you to the healer. I can't heal. I can't raise the dead. That's not within human ability to do that. And when men claim that, that's where it gets off base. But Jesus can. And my job is to point you toward the healer. Amen. Point you toward the Savior.
Thank you.
Jesus is the only answer to this beautiful life that we're talking about. This means walking circumspectly. And it tells us there in Colossians, the first chapter, to walk circumspectly. Do you know what that means? To walk circumspectly means to have an awareness of everything that's going on around you. Circle 360 degrees. An awareness of everything. It's okay to have an awareness. Amen. So to walk circumspectly is wise. Amen. And I think it's a good thing. That's why we listen to some news. We don't become slaves to the news channels. Very dangerous. Amen. They will feed you lies every day, all day long. But have some awareness through some trusted source so that you can walk circumspectly, like the Bible teaches us. Amen.
Amen.
So it means that we should walk circumspectly while having only one issue at the center of everything that we do, and that's obedience to Christ. Amen. So everything goes through the filter of the Word of God. I post this on Facebook quite often. I'm going to post it again, I think, this week. Rule number one in life is make Christ the centerpiece of your life. Do you know what rule number two is? Go to rule number one. Do you guys get that? Do you want me to try that one again? Okay?
Very good.
All right? And that's really the only answer. Amen. It is the only answer. And that's what you will hear from me from this pulpit. Amen. Christian simplicity is not just a faddish attempt to respond to the chaotic materialistic world in which we are found. It is a call given to every Christian in every age to follow Jesus Christ. No one has an option. Amen. There is only one way. Say one way to God. One way to heaven. One way to eternal life. Only one way, and that is Jesus Christ. What is the value of simplicity in the gospel? Simplicity is a part of our calling as a disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. We are called to live a simple life. Amen. The simplicity that is in Christ. He said, I am meek and I am lowly. How's that for starters? Amen. The value of simplicity is that it gives us freedom. Say freedom. You will walk out of here freer today if you listen to what this pastor is saying. You will walk out of here freer today because you're going to be free from what's binding you up.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Jesus modeled an amazing simplicity of life. He told his disciples as he sent them out. And this is in Matthew 10:9-10 in the NLT. Don't take any money. Don't take any money in your money belts. No gold, no silver, or even copper coins. Imagine that. That's when he sent his disciples out two by two in the early part of their ministry. He said, don't even take a change of clothes. Don't worry about where you're going to stay. Whoever you're ministering to, they will put you up and feed you. Wow. You know, I look at the church today and we look at what is popular in churches and it doesn't seem like it match anything we read in the Bible. Do you realize what the church is called to be? Amen. Not even to think about material things. Now, he was not teaching you to be reckless with your money. That's not what Jesus was saying. Don't be reckless with your money. Be wise with your money. That's a good testimony out toward others. Amen. You don't want to waste your money. You don't want to do that. Make sure that you're wise with your money. If God has given you some extra money, be wise with it. How to use it. How to spend it. How to help others. How to help the church. How to help a missionary. Do something today that will bless somebody else. Amen. This is so important. Jesus taught in Luke 12:15, and he said unto them, take heed and beware of covetousness, for a man's life consists not in the abundance of the things that he possesses. Amen.
Yes.
Period. Amen. Our life does not consist of what we own. If you're not careful, you can look at the bank account balance a little bit too often. And I've been guilty of that myself because I want to be wise. We're getting near retirement age, Carol and I, and I don't want to be a burden on my children. We're trying to be wise with our retirement. Amen. As we approach it, that's wisdom. That's a godly thing, guys. Amen. So the Bible is never teaching you to be reckless with your money. That's not what Jesus was saying. What he is saying is that you have to focus on the most important things when you're out there. Amen. Don't focus on how good you look or how much money you got. Believe me, you'll be taken care of. You go out there, you heal the sick, you preach the word, you share what I have taught you to say, and that I'll take care of you. You don't have to worry about provision. Amen.
Amen.
That's what he was saying. By simplifying these aspects of life, one can reduce stress. Say, reduce stress. Increase happiness. Sound good so far? So far, so good. Let's go to the third one. Create more time and energy to focus on what really matters. What really matters this Christmas, guys? Come on. How many lights you got out front of your house? I'm not saying it's wrong to have Christmas decorations. It's wonderful to celebrate the birth of Christ with decorations. I think that's wonderful. But don't become a slave to it. Amen. We have a house on King's Highway. That actually has a sign out front saying the Griswold House. Anybody remember that old movie? Chevy Chase, that was about 20 years ago. And he covered his house with lights. I mean, it's meant to be some kind of a humorous thing, you know. But, I mean, I can't imagine what this guy's electric bill is. I mean, his whole, not only his house, but his whole property is, I mean, it's got to be $2,500 a month electric bill just to run the lights. Amen. Think he just might be overdoing it a little bit? Come on, guys. Amen? By simplifying business operations, leaders can create a more efficient and effective organization. Amen. So if you own your own business, be wise in that. Amen. What is the greatest enemy of simplicity in life? Simplicity, by definition, is plain, natural, and easy to understand. The opposite of that is clutter in your life. Amen. Clutter. Clutter is the enemy of simplicity. I don't mean clutter on your kitchen counter, although it could be that. Clutter in the house is not good. Organization saves time, guys. Amen. It's a good thing to have a nice, neat house. Amen. But I'm talking about the clutter of the soul. I'm talking about the clutter of the mind. Amen. I'm talking about the poverty of the soul. Amen. How you think. And how you approach things and how you respond to things. That's the clutter of the mind. Amen. And one of the key enemies to simplicity is clutter. Amen. Clutter in your mind. Clutter in your life. Clutter in your... I mean, you can look at somebody's checkbook and see there's a lot of clutter in there. Amen. Come on. The Lord wants to set you free from stuff like this, guys. Amen. Today we're talking about the heart of Christ this Christmas. And I'm just simply saying that simplicity just might be a good idea. Amen? Since Jesus had that idea, I think it's a good one. What does simplicity mean in life? This is important. Simplicity is the clarity in which you will find the true meaning of life. It is the discovery of the things that you value the most. Value the most. In this movie that we enjoy, one of our favorite Christmas movies that we enjoy watching. It's somewhat humorous, but it's so good. And it's really good. This young lady gets the mail in, and she has all this stack of Christmas cards. And she stands in front of the trash can and starts throwing them in the trash can. So somebody next to her says, "What are you throwing them out for?" He says, "Well, I knew who they're from." So you don't even open them? No, I knew who they're from. And she just starts throwing them all in the trash can. Didn't even open them. So that night, her friend that was staying, or her uncle's friend that was there, and he comes and sit down, and she's writing out all these Christmas cards, and she's got this huge, big list, and she's writing all, staying up to 1-2 in the morning, right? And he says, "What are you doing?" He says, "Do you know all these people?" And she said, "Oh, of course, yeah." Then he picks one of the lists and says, "All right, now who is?" And he starts calling out these names. And she didn't know one person on that list. He's just on the list. So he gets a card. And then his friend said, "Why are you doing that? You just, get a card from them and you throw it in the trash." You hear what I'm saying? I'm talking about complicating your life. Amen. Make sure that the things you do this Christmas have value and meaning. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Through simplicity and the Spirit's power, we purposely remove the internal and the external clutter of our lives, preparing ourselves to enter God's presence with empty hands and a pure heart, ready to fully receive from Him and fully give to others. It sets you free to do what's really important in your life. Amen.
Amen.
What's really important in your life this Christmas? Well, with Carol getting this diagnosis, I'm telling you, you talk about making sure that you get a focus on the most important things. That'll bring focus real quick. Or if you lose a loved one, like Al passed away a couple years ago. I mean, all our life changes. You start to get a different look on life when something tough hits your life, don't you? Amen. And that's not a bad thing, It's a good thing. Say, it's a good thing that we can get our eyes focused on the most important things in our life. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm just recommending, guys. That's why I wanted to sing that song, Faye. I waited for you to get here to sing it. We're going to sing that song, Talking to Jesus. And I know it's your favorite. So we're going to do that. And it's such a simple thing to talk to Jesus, guys. Come on. It's so simple. Godliness with contentment. Let's just read one more scripture, then I'm through. I just love this subject. I couldn't wait to preach this sermon this morning. I thought, this has got to help somebody today. I mean, simplicity. 1 Timothy 6 and 6. But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and we can't take anything out either. Amen? Did you ever see a U-Haul behind a hearse? I've never seen a U-Haul behind a hearse. Have you? Come on. You can't take anything. But you know, this is such a beautiful thing, guys. Godliness with contentment is great gain. Amen. I trust that somebody was blessed by this message this morning. Yes. Amen. Yes. Hallelujah. Amen. We're talking about simplicity. Amen. Hallelujah. Lord, I thank you for this beautiful day. I thank you, Lord, for all that you have done. And I thank you, Lord, for this song that was written by this incredible young man that I just think it just has blessed so many people. Amen. Let's sing this song, shall we? Maybe you want to stand to your feet, change positions just for a moment. Amen. Here we go. You ready?
Mom used to pray out loud by your bed every night.
Amen. To me, it sounded like mumbling.
Sounded like mumbling. She was out of mind. She said, "Boy, this come and pray."
It's what saved my life.
It's what saved my life.
Amen.
You ought to try it some.
Amen.
Now I know she was right.
Oh yeah.
She was talking to Jesus.
Amen.
She was talking to Jesus.
Amen. She'd been talking to Jesus.
She'd been talking to Jesus for all of her.
We're talking about simplicity this morning, guys. Amen.
Mama used to drag me to church.
Amen. Sunday mornings and Wednesday
Sunday
nights.
Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights. Khaki pants and a polo shirt.
Boy, I put up a fight.
She said, "Son, one day you'll thank me."
Amen.
For having God in your
life. Amen.
And yeah, I know she was right.
Yeah, my mama was right.
Yeah, my mama was right. 'Cause now I'm talking to Jesus. She got me talking to Jesus.
Amen.
She got me talking to Jesus.
Yeah, my mama was right.
Because now I'm talking to Jesus.
Amen. Yeah, I love talking to Jesus. Amen.
And I'll be talking to Jesus.
Amen. For the rest of my life.
Amen.